Well, thank you very much for the introduction, Lars. So as Lars was commenting, my goal is going, I'm trying to give you a talk today about the functional reactive programming. It's an old field for which is not very well known among Scala, or I haven't seen too many Scala libraries around dedicated to the subject, but it's something that on the Haskell and some Haskell meetups and presentations that I often attend as a hobby, I have seen presented very often. And it's something that has always wrapped or challenged my mind to understand. And for a while I've been trying to see how could I understand it, because it's a bit complicated. It has like its own set of specialized type classes, and it's not something that from the outside is easy to approach. But on the other hand, I saw a lot of people trying to apply it on that community to things like multimedia applications or music generation or graphical user interfaces they could build with these kind of techniques. So this somehow tickled my back and bugged my mind. I thought, well, how could I try to understand this thing? And it wasn't something easy. So over the last years, I've tried to study these things sometimes in my spare time, and I have tried and I think about how could I explain it to somebody else. And what I'm going to do today and what I have found to work more or less effectively is to use a comparison with actors. And that is why actors, actor constructs, and actor patterns. So what I'm going to do today, and the goal of this talk, is going to give you an introduction to the subject of functional reactive programming, and FRP for short, just using a simple analogy or a very loose analogy with some restricted cases of the actor constructs. That's the only goal of this talk, by the way, just to help you understand FRP, or just something to that also have helped me to understand it. I'm not going to be presenting, by the way, any kind of original work by myself, first of all. This is based on work by others on the Haskell community. This is also not going to be any library that you should be able to do or to use right away in production, and this is not going to be something that you... I am also not going to try to tell you about what is the best approach to concurrency. I don't have yet an answer to that. I don't know enough. Just a little way to walk into that, not so far. Now, what I say, the way, when I thought about this talk, when I submitted the talk, the way I thought is, well, what's a nice way to explain functional reactive programming? Well, think about how can you, somebody explain it easily, those strange type classes, those strange concepts, like the contravariant functor. I told to myself, well, sometimes one of the easiest ways to understand these type classes is by using just the analogy with objects, and in particular with the so-called design patterns of object-oriented programming. So to give you a very tricky example, probably one of the most simple design patterns for object-oriented languages, one of the design patterns presented in that book from 20, 25 years ago, the Gang of Four design patterns, was what they call the adapter pattern. And the adapter pattern is a very simple idea. You have an interface, and you have a class, an implementation, for which you have the full implementation, and you want to use that class, that implementation, to perform this interface. But you don't have directly it implemented that interface. Well, what you can do in that case is to use the adapter. And one benefit they always had with the object-oriented design patterns, the adapter in this case is very simple. It's the idea that you have another object that is going to run the implementation that you have. The keynote of an hour ago by Martin was exactly presenting something like that in a very streamlined way. And that's something that the object-oriented data is. You build an object that is going to wrap this implementation you have while using it to implement this interface you need. And, of course, one of the benefits of these design patterns is that they were often very easy to understand because they were always appealing. Object-oriented programming always had a bit of a strength that it always appealed to everyday notions we always have. Probably many of you are using an adapter right now, but I don't suppose many of you have these funny Swiss plugs. So that's the idea. So in this simple case, if we have a method to print the strings that we want to print in, that's the simple trivial example is, well, we can just transform it into a method, into an object to print the strings just by changing the into a string. Now, that's simply the adapter pattern. If we also go somewhere else, we can also think that we have like a way of generating these adapters automatically, and the idea is you give me the function, a higher order, you give me a higher order method in which you give me the function about how to transform from one type or generic type the for which you have the implementation, like the string, how to transform an element of another type like the int into that, and I build you an adapter. And this is pretty much what we do in the functional programming with cats. That's pretty much what we do. The only difference is that that famous factory of adapters, we call it the contravariant functor type class, which is some kind of Latin for adapting the inputs in a way. That's almost what it comes down to. It's not difficult to understand. It's not too mathematical in itself. It's just what we are doing in a way, in a very restricted case, but under another name. If we, this is the approach I try to say, well, this is something that more or less can work, more or less can help to understand. How can we do the same with functional reactive programming? And that's what I did. So, getting back now into the matter about the reactive programming and the functional case, reactive programming is this method about building systems where we build programs and in which we have those programs like an operating system or a web server or anything in general in which we don't have something that is going to be like a batch process in which we think about all the inputs accumulated at the beginning, give them to it, start the program running, and then we have all the outputs. A reactive program is one in which we are always have the case in which we have new inputs. We have new inputs to process for the program, and we don't want the program to wait to all the inputs. We always want it to be generating a new output as inputs come along. It's something that almost continuously has to receive a new input, or what others will call, using the metaphor, reacting to new events in the environment, and we always want it to be generating new outputs, or to follow the analogy, acting over its environment. That's also, I think, where they have the metaphor about the reactive thing. Now, this is the general idea of reactive programming, and as you probably know, one of the most common approaches to implement reactive systems, reactive programming, is by having what is called an actor. And the actor model is this idea that your reactive program is going to be like a collection of actors sending messages to each other. Where an actor in this case is like the minimal or almost atomic, if you like, example of what a reactive system is going to be. Something that reacts to some events in the forms of messages it receives, something that acts upon its environment in the form of messages it sends to somewhere else, and something which must also have like its own state. Because one of the things about the reactive systems, of course, is that you always want to consider all of the history, all of the things that have happened before every message, so it always has a start to keep the collection or keep the summary of all of those interactions that ever happened before. And this also it's always common to think that an actor can always be thinking like a bit of an operational approach. An actor can always be thinking like a little wheel in one of these dented wheels that you know exactly what it does, you know exactly every time it ticks how it moves forward. You don't see exactly how it is connecting to the others or how it performs, but you can always see it like that. You are seeing the evolution of the system in terms of the state changes on the movements of that specific little piece, your actor, at that point. In that sense, that's why it's usually called an operational approach or an operational model of how reactive systems work. Now, if this is the operational approach, what will be a functional or a more declarative approach to implementing a reactive system? Well, in functional programming in itself is a very simple idea. Every program is just a function from some input type to some output type. That input type can be a string to an int, it can be a list of records of its and the strings and names and ages to another list of remuneration or salaries, if you like. It can be a list of actions on you are going. It can be a function of actions you are performing in the input to actions you are performing on the standard output of your command line. If we want to see a reactive system then as a functional programming, if we want to do functional programming for reactive systems, the question then will arise: if a reactive system will have to be a function of what? What will be, in this case, the input and the output type of a reactive system, if you see it as a function? Well, the answer that the starters of the field came about is the idea of the signal. And a signal is something that we usually have in the fields of audio processing or video processing. A signal, abstractly, is nothing more than a function over time. The idea that if you think of audio, it's just a vibration of pressure of the time, how the pressure of air changes over time. If we have of audio or a video, it's like at each time, or an animation, at each time we have like an image of what we are seeing at that moment in time. But there are also other kinds of signals. One often not very well understood kind of signal is the idea if you have, for finance, for stocks, you have a price of some tradable asset, you can see of the price and the quote of the price at every time, at every day for a long time, as a signal. You are seeing just some value is evolving through a period of time. That's the general idea of a signal. You are considering the whole of the time and the whole function of all time to a value as, yeah, the signal. And in that case, what you are going to have now is that your functional reactive programming, functional FRP simply means your reactive program is a function of one input signal or a signal of inputs to an output signal or a signal of outputs. That's the key idea you are going to have in FRP. This is going to give you a more declarative approach because at every point you are going to see, okay, this, you are always going to think of each function as if it were a very simple immutable entity, if you like, or nothing specifically tied to an implementation, just what you see or an observable behavior, if you like. And what you do then is that FRP simply means that the whole field of functional reactive programming has this idea that we want to build programs using this approach. And any program or a reactive system implemented in an FRP language is simply going to be a list of definitions of declarations to define or specify a set of signals, including your inputs and your outputs, but also any kind of intermediate signal or buffer you can have in the middle, and then a set of signal functions, which is transformations between those signals, or one or more signals, to another. An FRP language, in that case, what it's going to do, an FRP language or an FRP library for any language like Scala or Haskell, is just a set of methods in which you can build basic primitive signals, very simple ones, and then a method to connect them and to compose them into bigger programs. That's what a language under this paradigm should give you. Any questions so far, or if there's okay. Now, these are the ideas that have been, as Lars mentioned, in a field for several years, for over 20 years now. The question that will become so what I'm going to do now is to try to see a simple implementation I know. Now, if you don't understand this concept, I don't blame you because I myself, it took me a long time to understand it myself. So it's not a trivial idea how you can get to these abstractions of signals and signal functions. Something that helped me recently was to find a kind of implementation or a library, Haskell library, that has implemented these notions, which a kind of data structure, a kind of model called the monadic stream functions, which is what I'm going to try to introduce now. Because it serves as a very simple, just as actor serves as a very simple, almost atomic implementation of what a reactive system does from the operational view, I like to think of a monadic stream function as the minimal case of what a signal function can be in a more declarative approach. So, what a monadic stream function is just what you are going to see there, that MOSF, just for short, because I don't want just not to write too much, is a kind of function that is going to be parameterized, or generic in three parameters. The first one is going to be like an effect type, something that says under which effect, under which kind of runtime are we running these functions. And the rest are going to be like an input and an output. And what this kind of function is going to be is something that it has that it can be applied to an input parameter, and it's always, and when it is applied, it's going to give me an action or an effectful value that is going to have both an output value or a value of the output type and the idea of a continuation. And the idea of the continuation is that this is going to give me like the for the next step. The key idea here is that first of all we are trying to avoid being polymorphic, so this is not going to be tied to any specific runtime. That's the first goal of it. The second goal is that this is intended to be purely functional in the way not in the way that you have like an effect or they are wrapped and then you're always going to have like, the effects wrapping something and as long as you keep it there it's more or less controlled. This is purely functional in an old sense, which is you don't need any kind of destructive assignments, you don't need any kind of side effects. Every kind of value that is created through all the running of the program can be kept. It can be kept or it can be discarded, but it's not something that you, on the language itself, you need to deal with any kind of side effects or destructive updates. You are keeping that in the library itself or in the code itself, or in the interpretation of that code. So you don't have to handle that and you don't have to think about that, protecting against that. One easy way in which we can see that this kind of string function or the monadic string function is again by using an analogy with somehow loose analogy with a very restricted case of actor. If we were to think of an actor that will always take one input message and for every input message will always do one output message, that will be what the monadic string function is going to be like. In this case, the input and output parameters and input and output types will correspond to the input and output messages for the actor. So whenever the actor performs a new operation, it's always sending an output. And the continuation is this, the fact that that we are returning here a possibly new instance of the monadic string function over the same types. That's what is going to represent the next state. In an actor, what we have is a mutable state, self-contained and completely encapsulated to the actor, to be sure, but we are always mutating it. After each operation, it's been changed. Here, if we want to do it in a more purely functional way, we have to return just a new function, which is what is going to be used to process the next input. And that's what is going to correspond to the every change of the state or the behavior of the actor. The way to see this is that if we think of an actor as an actor is never an interpreter about what happens when it receives one message, it's always what happens when it receives one message and another and another, what is happening when it's receiving a flow of messages or a line queue. The way in which we can think about how a monadic string function and this kind of actor-like, if you like, is running is that if it's going to take, for instance, like a list of messages, the way that it's going to generate a list of outputs is always going to be that if the list is empty or if it's receiving no more messages, it's emitting nothing else. That also corresponds with the actor because the actor is always this idea that if it receives nothing, if it receives no messages, it's still quiet. The actors never have actions by themselves unless they have the message received. On the other hand, if it receives at least one more message, and the rest, well, what it's going to do is that first of all, it applies itself, or it applies the function itself to that message, the first input, the first value that comes in the input stream. And this is going to do, first of all, the first value of the output, and then the continuation. And this continuation that I mentioned is sort of representing the next state of the actor, or the next behavior. And what we will do next is that it will be that continuation. Oh. Sorry, an error there. It will be this continuation, what we will be using to run the following inputs, the rest of the inputs to follow. And that will be give us like in the same way, almost the same order in which we receive the inputs. Here we will be generating the outputs for that string function when applied through all of this list, or a stream if you like. That's more or less the basic of the analogy of thinking of this somehow abstract and polymorphic monadic string function as a very somehow specific, somehow narrow case of an actor. The next thing will be is, okay, now how can I start thinking about these basic constructs of the FRP or the monadic string functions if I were to think of them like maybe some kind of actor patterns. That was a bit what led me into this, and the way in which I also came to think of that is was because I had got familiar to a book about the act of patterns I have here with me, and that's where I started to see this thing that I started thinking, this is something that I could do very easily in an FP-like manner, just using an operator or just using a method. So that's also what started me with us with this path of thinking. So, in starting with these basic basic patterns, although the idea of an actor is usually that you have like a, its own state, and it's the state that it may be changing by each message it receives, may modify how it's going to react to the next, there is also the case that you can have sometimes like a kind of actors in which you don't have a state, a kind of actors in which you are doing like maybe a transformation of the input to an output, or maybe you are performing an action with the input. For instance, you could have an actor that all that it does is that receives identifiers as messages on the input messages, and it and what it does is like to look for an object in the database or just to run queries on a database. That will be a very simple kind of actor. It wouldn't have any specific behavior in itself, but you may have seen, or I don't know if you have ever seen that, something like that in any actor application if you've ever worked with that. It wouldn't be unusual, should we say. Well, if just as thinking of actors that have no state is a very simple pattern, the first kind of stream functions, monadic stream functions we can have are those that have no state. Now, if the idea of the state of the actor corresponded to the continuation of the monadic stream function, an actor that has no state, an actor that is always the same, corresponds to any kind of stream function that is always going to recur, that is going to continue with itself. So, to give you a simple example, we can have a monadic stream function that is always going to generate the same output value, almost completely ignoring the input. Well, the way in which we do that is we will be writing the output value and then the function itself, without any changes, as what the monadic stream function does in response to every input it receives. Or a more complicated case, if we have like an effectful function, like what I commented you about receiving an ID and querying for an object in the database, that could be represented with this kind of effectful function. Well, what we will do is that we will have a way to construct a monadic stream function that just takes every input it receives and applies this function to the function that you have given to this input. And what it's going to do is to transform the output it receives. This will be the map on the M effect, which we will have the functor capability. And we will be pairing that output just with the continuation itself, and the continuation of the function will be just itself. So there will be no special change of state in that case. Next, another. Any questions now? Another pattern that is sometimes you can see when you think of actors is that you sometimes have this idea of pipes or pipes as filters or a pipeline in general of actors, that you are going to have messages that you are going to be receiving, and for each message you are going to have a pipeline of actors. Every actor picks up an input, does a processing with it, and modifies its state and takes note of that input it has received, takes note of it into its state, and generates another output for the next actor. Then the next actor again takes that output and then generates, in this case, another output of another type. And every one of these messages is going, every message, let us suppose, every message here is going to correspond to a message sent from Anne to the actor Bob, and another message from the actor Bob to the actor Carl. But this is not just a composition of functions, a simple composition of functions. We have to think that every time one of these processes a message, it's going to somehow be changing, or we should reflect that it is changing its behavior. And the way you can represent it with the monadic stream functions and this simple model is to use this operator, this sometimes called the and-then operator of the triple greater than operator, and the idea is you have the first function that gives from an input to an output, and you have the second function that is going to take from the output of the first to a new output. And this is somehow similar, the profile, as you can see, somehow similar to the usual composition of functions. What we are going to do is combine and merge these two functions into a single function that is going to go from the input of the first to the output of the second. And the way we are going to do it is that this is going to be a function that... I forgot to mention, this is code using the single assignment method. If you are familiar with the Scala 2.12 construct, that's why we have this lambda. This will be the apply method and so on. This is going to take from the input of the first, and the way we change them is that, first of all, we apply the first function, and this is a monadic composition, so we're using the for comprehension. We apply the input to the first function, take the output of the first and the continuation of the first. Then we take the output of this first and apply it to the second function. So we get the output of the second function and the continuation and the second function. And what we are going then to emit in the next step is the output of the the output of the second function, and the continuation of this composition is going to be the composition of the two continuations we got for the two operations. Next, how long do I have? Sorry. All right. Next, another pattern that I read about for actor programming is that you sometimes have this idea of a message translator, that in some actor system you have a specific actor whose only role is to take the inputs or input messages that arrive, like maybe from another remote system or a very different system, and it sends messages that may not be compatible with the local actor application. So this is an actor that what it's going to do is just to adapt the messages it receives from the remote system to something that can be understood by the local system. Well, one simple way in which we could build something like this is if we have, for instance, for the int and the string things we had before, we could just simply pick up the basic constructor we had before to lift a function into a monadic string functions. This was one of the constructors here, just to pick up a function and apply the result of the function in a pure context. And we could do this compose to the base, in this case being what we already have, the local system. Or we can just do what we were doing at the beginning, which is simply to define for these string functions and just a map and a contramap method. A contramap method again, in which we say, okay, I'm going to adapt the input I receive from the remote or from the other system simply by saying that I take this function to adapt it, and the function to adapt it, use it to build a new monadic string function that takes as inputs the elements of the other type, of the remote object type, applies the conversion, applies the function to the converted result, and then what I do is that I take the output and the continuation of this function, and I pair it with the, and what I have to do is again contramap the continuation. Always the key here in this method is that you always have to like apply the same kind of transformation you apply in the, be it compose or mapping or contramapping, you always have to apply to the continuation, saying that you are transforming like the whole thing or the whole execution. One more pattern, how long? 3 minutes, okay. One more pattern, and this is a bit more interesting, is that sometimes you have from a same channel or from a same queue, you are going to receive like probably several types of messages, and maybe you have like several actors already implemented. One of them is going to handle one type of messages, the other type of actor is going to handle the other type of messages. So in this case, we have like Bob and Carl. Bob only handles the M messages, Carl only handles the November messages. What we do then? Well, we have a channel that's going to receive both. So what do we do? We do here something called a context-based router, another actor that just, if it's the message for Bob, it sends it to Bob, or if it's the message for the actor Carl, it sends it to the actor Carl. That's all that this context-based routing is doing. A router in general actor programming, a router is just an actor that is going to be sending messages to another actor, almost unaltered. And the context-based router is this pattern in which you analyze the content to see to which actor you send it. How can we implement that then on something similar with the string functions? Well, we use this operator, which is if the actor cal corresponds to this function on the left and the actor bob corresponds to this function on the right, which the latter assume that they have different input and output types, what my context-based router is going to be is I'm going to merge these two functions I have separate into a new function. And this function is going to be for inputs that either the input of both of the one function or the input of the other function. And it's going to be, and what is going to generate as output is going to be either the output of the first one or the output of the second one. And because this is an either, I'm going to call them on the left or on the right. And what these functions are doing is that, okay, if I receive a left, I send it to the function on the left, and the result, which is to say the effectful value with the result and the continuation, I take it and then I will put it with the continuation on the left and just the function I had on the right not modified. So every time I receive a message, it's going to be sent and modified and get the output and probably get the continuation of one of those, either the one on the left or the one on the right, but not both. The other one continues unchanged. So this is how we can correspond, like operating with routing, with operating with either with this operator. But the important part, of course, with the functional reactive programming is that it's always operators. It's not some, usually when we think of design patterns, it's something that is on paper and we have to see on the code, but these are always operators we see on the code. We don't have to imagine themselves. That's pretty much the approach I've tried to follow. That's the way at which I have started to think of these matters, and which I think is going to be a bit useful to try to see or to try to approach, especially for people who are not very familiar with the abstract reasoning or we are more familiar with object-oriented programming. I hope that this talk has been useful to you, and yeah, just to mention a few of the books or papers that I read to learn about this stuff, one of the books being the one about actor programs I have there, and I think I'm done with that.
Yeah, thanks a lot. Any questions?
So in actor system, mm-hmm. sometimes you have two-way communications where, say, an actor A sends mm-hmm. a message to an actor B, and then actor B responds with another message. Is that something you can also model with FRP in some way?
If you can model the fact that normally an actor, you can have a request and reply, maybe a subsequent message, or I don't know if you're referring particularly to the ACA pattern of the question mark. Yeah. So FRP introduces a bit of a very more complex concept construct, which is the idea of a loop. That sometimes you can have the idea of representing that sometimes you can have a function that generates two outputs, but the second type of the output is also the first input or the second input. So you can do a construct which is like a loop, that it's going to feed back the output that it gets in each step as the input, as an input or accumulator for the next step. That's a way in which they represent it. And I suppose that's something we can use to try to implement this kind of thing.
Can you translate any actor system into FRP?
No, this is a very loose analogy for a very restricted case that I have tried to follow as a way to approach what I saw at first as a very intimidating, or at least I found it, sir, I don't know, you as a very intimidating concept of type. I don't think I can claim that it's complete. I know that people are using FRP systems like this one to build very complex applications, and I don't know if any of those is distributed. I know there are some people working in some FRP languages, and what they are doing is like an automatic translation to, on the other sense, that an FRP language they translate to actors. That's some research that I found out about quite recently, in fact, like maybe 1 week, 2 weeks ago. But I wouldn't claim that this analogy is going to be very complete or very extend too far.
Okay, so let's thank Diego again.